concept of IP Dendo has been there for quite some time because we have been trying to solve problems in a easy fashion so that we are able to really identify and evaluate complicated pediatric endocrine problems in an appropriate fashion. Number of approach pathways which will allow you to approach to a particular endocrine condition, manage pathways, calculators, diagnostics, therapeutics, and knowledge management. So, how does it work? We have got 31 approach pathways, which basically covers every condition that you will encounter as a pediatric endocrinologist. We have got around 13 management pathways, which cover the various possibilities. And when you talk about these pathways, they actually look simple when you solve them, but they are actually very complicated algorithms. So there are various weightages which are given to different situations so that we want to select the lowest resources required to reach a diagnosis. So if you want to evaluate for growth failure, we would like to keep IGF-1 at the end. If you want to evaluate for some complicated calcium disorder, we'll keep calcitriol at the end. So the algorithm is designed so as to ensure that it is resource appropriate and the cost-benefit ratio is there in that situation. Then we provide personalized, prescriptionized management, and we'll discuss that all throughout that. Now, it basically is a very simple user interface. You just go to the disorder you're looking at, and then you answer a few questions. Yes, no, you will get the answer. And we'll go through about that in that situation. Now, this is available at both the Android as well as the iOS platforms. You can just go and download from there. All you have to do is to register. You will have a free access for 7 days for the entire app in which you can look through. After that period, you will have access to specific things which are essential, like growth interpreter, like DK. A few of them will remain. Others are for a very nominal subscription in that regards. Now, many of these courses come bundled with their subscriptions. So if you take the course, automatically the bundle becomes from there. Just to go through a bit, the approach pathway basically uses evidence-based algorithm approach. And the way it is that you have to choose a condition. So suppose you want to approach delayed puberty in boys, you will answer a few questions and all these are taking you to one section of algorithm. Now there will be around 100 possibilities which are there, but you will reach, like in this case, you have reached 70 beta HSD deficiency. So it will end up at a particular diagnosis. Now this is counterintuitive, but this is going to be quite helpful in reaching a diagnosis when you don't have access to expertise, which is not there everywhere. Management pathways similarly use algorithmic approach. So like if you have hyperkalemia, it will ask the level of potassium, ECG changes, then it will guide you through with emergent management. So all your protocols are pretty much there. You don't need to go ahead and read it, and we give information specifically about doses also if it's required at that point of time. The diagnostic sections was developed largely by Dr. Riti. And it provides extensive information. So if you want to prescribe a test, it will give you all the information which is relevant. And every single test which is there in pediatric endocrinology is provided there, along with ranges which are difficult to find often in that situation. The therapeutics by Dr. Sajini has around 64 drugs used in pediatric endocrinology. If you want to know about any in terms of doses, indications, contraindications, you will get all information about a particular drug. Like for desmopressin, it provides this information. So,
as we all know, that 99% of total body calcium is stored in the bones in the form of hydroxyapatite crystals, and it is only the 1% of calcium in the bone which is available for exchange with the serum calcium. The total calcium present in the serum is either bound to the negative anion, that is albumin, constituting nearly 40%, and the remaining 10% is bound to the phosphate ions. So it is only the 50% of ionic calcium which is responsible to carry out the functions of calcium in different organ systems of the body. So this ionic calcium not only depends on the level of phosphate and albumin in blood, but it also depends on the acidity of blood. In case of high pH, that is alkaline blood, the negative component of albumin rises and the binding of total calcium to albumin rises, further decreasing the amount of ionic calcium. This alkalosis could either be respiratory alkalosis or metabolic acidosis leading to hypocalcemic symptoms. Particularly in ICU settings, we find cases of hyperventilation leading to respiratory alkalosis, And in cases of sodium bicarbonate infusion, such as in chronic renal insufficiency, we should rather be very careful before infusing sodium bicarb, as this may precipitate decrease in ionic calcium, leading to symptoms. So calcium homeostasis is regulated by three main organs in the human body, and that is the gut, bone, and the renal system. The bones is responsible for the acute calcium regulation, gut is responsible for subacute regulation, while kidneys are responsible for the long-term regulation of serum calcium. Along with these three organ systems, we have three main hormones playing role in maintaining calcium homeostasis. The fourth most important hormone is the parathyroid hormone, which is produced by the parathyroid gland. It acts on the bone to produce calcium from, to bring calcium from bone to blood. It acts on the kidneys to increase absorption of calcium, and it promotes excretion of phosphorus. So in summary, it is a hypercalcemic and hypophosphatemic hormone. On the other hand, we have calcitriol, which is the activated form of vitamin D. This vitamin D enhances calcium absorption from gut, kidneys, and thereby it is a hypercalcemic and hyperphosphatemic hormone. The point to emphasize here is that serum phosphorus acts as an important differentiating lab marker to differentiate between PTH-related and PTH-independent disorders, because PTH acts on the phosphorus in a reversible direction as compared to vitamin D. PTH decreases serum phosphorus level, while vitamin D increases phosphorus level. The third hormone is calcitonin, which is produced by the parafollicular cells or the C cells of the thyroid gland. This is not a very important hormone in the human body, as can be evident by normal calcium levels in scenarios such as medullary carcinoma of thyroid, in which calcitonin production is sky high, or in total thyroidectomy, where calcitonin production is totally abolished. Then there is a role of calcium receptor. Serum calcium is sensed by calcium receptor, which then signals the parathormone to be shut down in case of high calcium, and whenever the calcium is low, it causes the secretion and production of parathormone from the parathyroid glands. There can be disorders affecting calcium receptor, such as activating mutations or inactivating mutations, which will be discussed further with the help of few cases to understand in a better way. Coming on to fetal physiology. So as we know, there is a transplacental transfer of calcium from mother to fetus with the help of channels such as CRPB5, 6 and calcium ATPase, and these ensure that there is a transgradient movement of calcium from mother to fetus, ensuring a normal calcium level in fetus despite low calcium in mother. So 80% of calcium accrual takes place in the third trimester, and thereby newborns who are born premature are at higher risk of developing hypocalcemia. There is a role of PTH-related peptide, which is produced by placenta, which ensures the movement of calcium from maternal to fetus side against a gradient of 1.4:1. During early phase of pregnancy, there is production of PTH-related peptide in the mother as well, which ensures movement of calcium from bone to blood. And in the later half of pregnancy, we have increased production of calcitriol in mother, which ensures increased absorption of calcium from gut. So in a net, there is a normal bone health in mother during the pregnancy. So fetus calcium is not totally dependent on the maternal transfer of calcium. It has its own PTH axis as well. So when after delivery there is shutdown of movement of calcium from the mother to fetus, there comes a role of the fetus own PTH axis. So the first response to decreased fetus calcium is an increase in parathyroid secretion. The second response is a decrease in calcitonin, and then comes an increase in calcitriol. So vitamin D dependent calcium disorders in fetus newborn are rare, and they present as late hypocalcemia, that is beyond 3 weeks of life. So this fetal physiology is responsible for a physiologic dip in the ionic calcium level, which is more pronounced in the preterm neonates due to decreased calcium accrual, as they have missed the important phase of third trimester. And depending on the gestation and age, we have different cutoffs, which will be discussed further. So calcium has variable role in human organ systems, starting from bone strength to nerve function to cardiac conduction, enzyme release in pancreas, action of antidiuretic hormone and gut motility. Hence, disorders affecting calcium have widespread manifestations. So depending on the levels, 8 to 12, 8 to 10 is considered as a normal calcium level. To convert milligram per year into millimoles, you have to divide it by 4. So within this range, the person is asymptomatic, and below this range, we develop symptoms as chittiness, tetany, apnea, and seizures. So in a newborn, unexplained apnea, seizures should always alert a physician to get a calcium level done. Similarly, high calcium can present with irritability, polyuria, because calcium levels affect the antidiuretic hormone action, hypertension, dehydration, encephalopathy, and seizures again with hypercalcemia. So serum calcium should always be taken as an early morning sample in a fasting state. It is a serum sample. The pitfalls are because it is bound to albumin, so conditions associated with hypoalbuminemia such as nephrotic syndrome, chronic liver disease can falsely produce a low calcium level, while high protein condition can be associated with high calcium levels. To correct for the level of albumin, you have this formula of corrected calcium, which gives for 1 gram decrease in albumin, there has to be an increase of 0.8 milligram per deal in calcium level, which should be corrected. So these are the different cutoffs which I was talking about depending on the gestation and birth weight. Similar to calcium, serum phosphorus should also be collected in a fasting sample. It is a serum sample again. Caution is because it is an intracellular iron, one should not use a tourniquet or a squeeze sample as it may give a falsely high value. And age-specific phosphorus level should always be used because in children, phosphorus levels are comparatively high as compared to adults, and these should not be misconfused as a high phosphorus level in infancy or childhood when we compare it with adult reference values, which is often given in the blood reports. Alkaline phosphatase, which is a marker of bone turnover, is collected as a serum sample. It is very high in rickets or during the treatment phase, and it is also high during the hypoparathyroid conditions, and this extremely low alkaline phosphate levels. Alkaline phosphatase is produced by liver, bone, placenta. So in children who don't have a liver disease, majority of the ALP in blood is marker of a bone-responsible ALP. So ALP levels is again dependent on the age. In children, they are comparatively high as compared to adults. And again, I would like to specify that age-specific references should always be used in interpreting calcium profile. Serum magnesium is an important marker to be analyzed in cases of hypocalcemia, hypokalemia, and alkalosis. It is a serum sample which is to be collected, and fasting is always good to go with. Precaution again, as in phosphorus, a tourniquet should not be applied, a squeeze sample should not be taken, as it can give a falsely high serum magnesium value. So the normal values range from 1.5 to 2.5 mg per year, and here we have the conversion to the millimoles per liter. Parathormone is a thermolabile hormone, and its collection and transport is very important whenever we are planning to get it done for our patient. The indications to get PTH level done is any child presenting with low calcium and high phosphorus. So just to remind, as we discussed in physiology, parathormone is a hypophosphatemic hormone. If there is a high phosphorus in presence of low calcium, the only two conditions one needs to keep in mind is chronic kidney disease or parathormone insufficiency or resistance. The second condition to do a parathormone is any child presenting with a high calcium level, rickets, and a high phosphorus. So precaution in collecting a parathormone sample is that it is a thermolabile. It should be collected immediately and transported in ice before it degrades and gives you a falsely low value. The normal values range from 10 to 55 picogram per ml, and it should always be analyzed in context with calcium as with any other hormone profile. So interpretation of parathormone always depends in context with calcium. So in presence of low calcium, we expect PTH to compensate for the level of low calcium. So even in presence of a normal PTH, this is low. This is an inappropriately normal PTH for the level of low calcium. So low PTH or normal PTH in the presence of low calcium depicts hypoparathyroidism, while a high PTH in low calcium depicts secondary hyperparathyroidism as seen in cases with chronic kidney disease. A high calcium with a high PTH or an inappropriately normal PTH in the level of high calcium is indicative of hyperparathyroidism. Vitamin D assessment is done in cases of hypocalcemia and hypophosphatemia in children presented with rickets. 25 OHD is an important marker of vitamin D status as it is have a longer half-life and it is independent of PTH action. The levels, there is quite a controversy depending on the levels which to be used for vitamin D analysis. What we take is 20 to 50 nanogram per ml as the normal vitamin D level. And in nanomoles, it changes to 50 to 150 nanomoles per liter. So the consensus guideline given by Indian Academy of Pediatrics in 2017 has clearly elaborated the vitamin D levels defined for insufficiency, deficiency, and normal range. Thank you, and over to you.
Nice presentation, and you covered a lot of these topics very well. Now it becomes much easier from our side to discuss about those cases, and I'd like to invite Dr. Sayan to run through a few cases of calcium disorders, and Neha is there to help him out in terms of finding the right diagnosis and whether the app is giving the right diagnosis or not. So I think we'll start from there, Sayan.
So a 4-month-old boy with nephrotic syndrome presented with calcium levels of 7.2 milligrams per deciliter at an albumin level of 2. So Dr. Neha, would you like to take it forward from here?
So whenever we have a child who presents with hypocalcemia, I would like to know whether the child is symptomatic or asymptomatic.
Is asymptomatic.
So in presence of an asymptomatic child and a background condition of nephrotic syndrome, and we also have a low albumin level, as we discussed, we should get it corrected. For every 1 gram per liter decrease in albumin, a 0.8 correction is required for calcium. And here we have a corrected calcium with the use of our MediClasses app, which quickly gives us a corrected calcium of 8.8, suggesting that it is a normal calcium and nothing to be evaluated or worried about.
Yes. A 4-year-old girl presented with symptoms of tetany had an ionic calcium of 3.1 milligrams per deciliter. The phosphate was high, 8.4 milligrams per deciliter, had a parathyroid hormone level of 130 picomoles per liter, was diagnosed as a case of pseudo-hypoparathyroidism.
Do you agree, Neha, with this diagnosis?
Again, I would like to specify that any child presenting with hypocalcemia and hyperphosphatemia, creatinine is a very important test to be done before moving ahead with analyzing PTH hormone even. So in this child, as I can see, that creatinine level has not been displayed. So I would like to know if creatinine was done or not before doing a PTH.
Yes, it was 2.4 milligrams per deciliter.
So this test suggests that it is a CKD-like picture rather than a pseudo-hyperparathyroidism. And alongside we have the app which is displaying likely renal failure, and it goes very well with our clinical intuition as well.
So big message is high phosphorus, do creatinine first before doing anything else.
Yes.
Carry forward.
A 10-year-old boy with seizures had an ionic calcium of 2.1 milligrams per deciliter. Phosphate was 4.4 milligrams per deciliter, had a parathyroid hormone level of 12 picomoles per liter. Did not respond to heavy calcium.
So Neha, you said that if the PTH is inappropriately normal with hypocalcemia, that becomes hypoparathyroidism. Do you agree with that? Do you think this is hypoparathyroidism?
So again, I would like to remind, based on the physiology, if you look at the phosphorus level, had it been hypoparathyroidism as given by the value of 12 picomole per liter, the phosphorus should have been high. So we need to know about the serum magnesium levels and the vitamin D level as well in a refractory hypocalcemia cases. As I can see, there is no response to multiple doses of IV calcium.
The magnesium level, Dr. Neha, was 6 milligrams per deciliter in this case.
This was clearly a case of hypomagnesemia not responding to IV calcium and leading to refractory hypocalcemia. So if we go alongside our app.
So if you look at the app, basically it is designed to do simpler investigations first, which should be the way your clinical practice should be. So look at creatinine, look at magnesium, look at all those things before you go ahead with PTH. So I think Neha is very methodical in the way she's saying that this is hypomagnesemia. PTH was not required. You should not have done a PTH at this point of time.
A 3-month-old girl presented with seizures had an ionic calcium of 3.2 milligrams per deciliter. The phosphate level was 2.2 milligrams per deciliter. The parathyroid hormone level in this case was 3.4 picomoles per liter and was diagnosed as a case of hypoparathyroidism.
Do you agree, Neha, with this? Phosphorus is low.
And again, to emphasize, we have a low phosphorus in presence of a low PTH, which is not possible. So since PTH is a thermolabile hormone, I would like to repeat PTH before labeling the child with the condition of hypoparathyroidism.
So if we go by the app, what it says is that look at the level of phosphorus, it's not high. Look at magnesium, it is not low. The next would be vitamin D.
Yes.
So PTH will not even come into the picture. So PTH should come only when it is required, when you have high phosphorus, normal creatinine, and should be done in a proper fashion. Otherwise, you will have an erroneous result like that. So I think this way, this Neha's approach that she presented very methodologically will be very relevant from a clinical practice.
A 1-week boy presented with seizures had ionic calcium of 2.4 milligrams per deciliter. His phosphate level was very high at 9.1 milligrams per deciliter. The creatinine levels were normal. So as per the previous case which we already mentioned, a low calcium, high phosphorus, always go for a creatinine before further workup. His parathyroid hormone level was now done and it came to be 2 picograms per ml.
So do you think this is hypoparathyroidism, Neha, now?
Yes, with hypocalcemia and hyperphosphatemia in the presence of a normal renal function with a low PTH level, there is a likely possibility of hypoparathyroidism, and because the age of presentation is also in the early neonatal period, which points towards the genetic forms, and we should look further in terms of facies of the child and different cardiac disorders associated with it.
So as you already mentioned, the child was worked up and a cardiac defect was found in this case.
So this was like
you can
DiGeorge
go ahead syndrome. With fish analysis for DiGeorge syndrome.
So the next case is a 10-year-old boy with seizures
and hypocalcemia. So what do you think, Neha, just based on this CT scan?
In view of seizures, probably the treating physician got a neuroimaging done, which shows intracranial calcification, particularly in bilateral basal region. And this is very suggestive of pseudo-hypoparathyroidism-like conditions. So we may like to have a look at the clinical picture of the child on clinical examination.
So
biochemical evaluation was done, which shows high phosphorus level. And if we go by our algorithm, we need to get a serum creatinine, which is normal. And now we have a high PTH level suggesting of pseudo-hypoparathyroidism.
And what were you looking for in clinical examination, Neha, in the case?
So we need to look at the ocular examination to search for cataract, some subcutaneous calcinosis in the flexor areas, or there might be brachymetacardia if you flex the fingers of the child.
So I think this is a very interesting situation of any calcification with seizures, think of a PTH abnormality. That is a big message. Carry forward.
So the next case is that of a 12-day-old girl presenting with irritability. She had dehydration. The calcium level was very high at 18 milligrams per deciliter. So kindly take the case forward, Dr. Neha.
So the child is in 12 day old, just a very early days of life, presenting with irritability, and general evaluation shows hypercalcemia. So going by our algorithm, the PTH level will be done. And may I have the PTH value? So
yeah, it is very 120 picograms.
Yeah, so PTH is very high, so the next investigation that will give us the clue is the urine calcium to creatinine ratio, which is, may I have the value, which is quite low in the presence of high calcium level. So if we go back to our physiology, there was a disorder, inactivating mutation of the calcium sensing receptor, which despite the serum calcium being in normal range, will detect serum calcium to be low and trigger parathormone secretion from parathyroid gland. So these cases are familial, and we should get a level done for parents as well for serum calcium and urine calcium creatinine ratio. So in heterozygous cases, these present with familial hypercalcemic hypocalciuria, and these are often not detected. But if one has a homozygous mutation, these are severe forms of neonatal hyperparathyroidism and require genetic. So till now, the only treatment for neonatal severe hyperparathyroidism was total parathyroidectomy. But recent some cases have been published in which cenacalcet, which is a stimulant of calcium sensing receptor, has been used. And children are doing quite well up to the first and second year of life as well. Sorry, sir, you were saying something.
Yeah, yeah. So I was just adding two points to that. One is that anybody with high calcium should have a high urinary calcium. So just like when we say DI, you have got dilute urine and concentrated serum. Same here, if you have got high calcium, low in the urine, there is a calcium sensing defect. And your cenacalcet point is very valid. But if somebody has a calcium of 18, this is most likely a homozygous defect, which will require surgery. There is a very interesting variant of calcium sensing receptor, which is basically when the gene comes from the father. So what happens is that the child is sensing mother's calcium as low, even though it is normal because the sensing is defective. So in that heterozygous case, there will be what is known as neonatal hyperparathyroidism. So you have to always be very cautious whether it is a homozygous or a heterozygous defect. And that may improve over time also, because with time the desensitization happens on that. So that cases will respond to cenacalcet. Cenacalcet definitely, along with pamidronate or zoledronate, is the very good modality in the initial treatment of hypercalcemia. But if you have very severe defects, often ultimately surgery may be required. So it will of course depend upon the clinical course and how the child will respond. It's a very, very important point that Neha put in out there. California.
This case is of a 4-day-old boy who presented with seizures, had a birth weight of 3.2 kg, had asphyxia, had a calcium level of 80 mg per deciliter, phosphate levels were 4.2. PTH levels were done and it was found to be less than 1 picograms per ml.
So what do you think, Neha, out here? Your hyperparathyroidism is out. What could it else be?
So in the background history, we have this asphyxia and this 4-day-old boy presenting with seizures as well due to hypercalcemia. I would like to do a general examination of the neonate to rule out any fat necrosis present in body, which is responsible for the production of activated form of vitamin D, that is 125-OHT. So getting a 25-OHT and 125-OHT might give us a clue in this case. So if we have the values available here.
Yeah, the 25-OHT was 30 nanograms per ml and the calcitriol was 250.
So as we can see from these values, that the calcitriol is sky high, and this is a 1-alpha hydroxylase which is produced in the granulomatous tissue, that is fat necrose tissue, which is responsible for the conversion of vitamin D into activated form, responsible for increased absorption of calcium. So this is a self-limiting condition requiring just fluid and steroids in symptomatic cases.
The subcutaneous lymph nodules were present in this patient, and as Dr. Neha already mentioned, the cause of the hypercalcemia in this case. So a 2-year-old boy presented with rickets. So in case of rickets, how do we manage the case with reference to dose, the preparation we give, the route we delivered the vitamin D in this in rickets case, and also how do we follow up the case over the long run?
So as we can see from the radiograph, that it is a clear-cut picture of flared rickets having all the features of cupping, fraying and metaphysis, and there are different guidelines recommending different doses of vitamin D globally. IEP in 2017 has come up with a consensus recommendation for the dose, preparation, route and follow-up of vitamin D and calcium in these cases. And we have a complete algorithm present in our MediClasses app as well as the algorithm. And before giving a treatment to any child, I would recommend everyone to kindly go to the app and not just based on your memory. Because often we tend to give underdoses and label the child as refractory rickets, unnecessarily preventing so many complications of repeated blood samples that the parents and the child have to go through. Especially in this corona times, they should not be coming to hospital for multiple visits. So rather we should...
Do you think of refractory rickets in this case, or you have to wait and watch?
So we don't know about the dose and preparation given in this case. So it would be difficult to say it's nutritional or refractory here.
So unless there is at least a good dose, at least 6 to 8 weeks, and sometimes maybe better for up to 12 weeks also, which may be a daily dose, a weekly dose. We don't believe in the stress therapy anymore, although people do recommend that. Injectable form is only relevant with malabsorption. There is no role of giving injections routinely because they will cause hypercalcemia, hypervitaminosis, and they will fall it off from there. What is the role of calcitriol in this treatment? Many people give calcitriol. Neha, do you agree?
Just in the first presentation of the child.
Yeah, so we do see reports, orthopedicians, they give calcitriol. Do you think it's required?
No, sir. Calcitriol has no role in the first presentation itself. Only when we have proven that
people have hypercalcemia. So we should not use activated form of vitamin D. You need 10 times the usual dose if you want to really heal the rickets. You need to give a huge amount of calcitriol to heal the rickets, and this will cause hypercalcemia. So they've got no role at all. So yeah, carry forward. So just to highlight the approach, Neha, can you just go through the approach of rickets?
Yeah, so on the first presentation of a child with rickets, always and always give a calcium and vitamin D trial in adequate doses for adequate duration before letting the child has refractory rickets. After giving adequate doses, even if the child is not responding clinically and radiologically, then expose the child to further investigations, among which we have a panel comprising of phosphorus. Depending on the level of phosphorus, if it is low, the next comes in picture is the blood gas. So all these are done simultaneously, and you don't have to call the child again and again 10 times going by the algorithm. So you should have all the investigations in hand and then analyze the reports a little bit. So if phosphorus is low and blood gas shows a low pH, it goes more in favor of acidosis, that is renal tubular acidosis. If the blood gas is normal, the second line of investigation is to get a pH done. If PTH is high, we need to get a calcitriol level done. If calcitriol is low, it is a vitamin D dependent rickets type 1. While if calcitriol level is high, that is the resistance at the receptor level, it is vitamin D dependent rickets type 2. On the other hand, as we have seen in the physiology, high phosphorus has only two conditions, that is chronic kidney disease and pseudohypoparathyroidism. So getting a creatinine level done is very important in any child presenting with metabolic bone disease. And if it is high, the child needs evaluation for chronic kidney disease.
I think one big message out here is that do not do calcitriol in the beginning. We have had two cases who were referred to us as BDDR type 2, in which calcitriol was done, which was found to be high. Now, this calcitriol is a PTH dependent, and in vitamin D deficiency, it may be normal, low, or high. Especially if somebody has received vitamin D recently, actually the body is waiting to convert into calcitriol, and your calcitriol levels may be sky high immediately after giving a single dose of vitamin D. So do not do calcitriol unless and until you have a refractory rickets with a normal blood gas, normal calcium, and low calcium and a high PTA. That is the only indication in which calcitriol is done. And we are trying to do is to not do unnecessary investigations. So as you said, phosphorus and creatinine, calcium would be the good ones to begin with. Then maybe blood gas, PTH, and then finally calcitriol. This will be the way you will save a lot of money unnecessarily. It will not be required.
So, carry it over. So a 3-year-old boy with rickets was given vitamin D, presented with bone pain and a high alkaline phosphatase level. So kindly take this forward, Dr. Neha.
So as we discussed with the analysis of alkaline phosphatase, that alkaline phosphatase could be high in rickets as well as during the treatment of rickets. And bone pain is also a manifestation while the child is healing from rickets. So this is a normal response to healing rickets, and getting the X-ray done and confirming rickets healing is, and counseling the parents is all that is needed.
That this is the same thing that the app shows. It gives us the inference that complete the course of calcium and vitamin D and not to worry about the bone pain and the high ALP at this point of time, and to go in for an X-ray and see the healing line in this case. The next case is that of a 12-year-old girl with multiple fractures. On history, she also had failure to thrive, polyuria and myopathy.
So what do you think, Neha? This looks like a simple rickets, nutritional rickets, or something more?
So if there is clinical features such as polyuria, myopathy or failure to thrive, we should suspect something more than just nutritional rickets. So in this 12-year-old girl who is having multiple fractures, predominantly affecting the lower limbs, which is more common in a condition such as discotibular acidosis. I would like to get a panel done that we did for refractory rickets, that is ABG done, phosphorus levels, and vitamin D levels done. Do we have ABG for this child?
Phosphate level was 2.1 at a low pH and a excess of minus 14.
Child has metabolic acidosis with low phosphorus, pointing towards renal tubular acidosis. Getting a urine pH done will help us distinguish between a proximal RTA and a distal RTA. So, as the algorithm says that the urine pH was less than 5.5 in this case, it is more likely distal RTA. As in proximal RTA, urine pH is able to be more than 5.5.
This is very important. The distal RTA should be considered in this situation with multiple fractures, pathological bone disease. Very, very important in that setting.
A 14-year-old boy presented with rickets and was sent to us with as a case of refractory rickets. His phosphate was 1.8, base excess was minus 4, had a normal calcium.
And a normal pH.
Yes.
So this is an adolescent boy in which we can see that the predominant involvement of lower limbs with a pH normal, there is no acidosis, but phosphorus is markedly low in the presence of a normal calcium and PTH level, pointing towards a case of hypophosphatemic rickets requiring further genetic evaluation to look for the cause of hypophosphatemic rickets in this case. And in the upper limb X-ray, we can see.
Yeah, so normal PTH, normal calcium, low phosphorus, diagnostic of hypophosphatemic rickets in this setting.